of TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
7 p.m. meeting of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners. I am Board Chair Amy Scott Gailey, and Commissioner Sutton is not here tonight, but we have Vice Chair Boswell, Commissioner Lashley, and Commissioner Carter are present. So, Commissioner Carter, if you would please lead us in the invocation and the Pledge of Allegiance.
Sure. Join me in prayer, please. Father God, as we join together here tonight to do the business of the people of Alamance County, we seek, dear Lord, for the strength that only you can provide, for the peace and comfort that only you can provide. But most of all, dear Lord, we seek for wisdom and courage to know what's right and to do what's right for the citizens of Alamance County. And Father God, we just seek safety for those who've joined us tonight as we when we finally leave here and seek an opportunity, dear Lord, to find the solutions to the problems that we deal with in our community. We ask these things, dear Lord, in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, before we get into the main part of our meeting tonight, we have a special group of people to recognize the 2019 Fall County Government Academy, what we call County Government 101. So I'm going to come around, and we have some presentations. So this is a group of folks who signed up to come to, how many weeks of class was it?
Ten
weeks of class, and they learned a lot. I know we have some graduates of County Government 101 also present tonight. They went to the landfill 1 week, the Department of Social Services. They learned about the emergency services, and quite a few things. And so I have some certificates to present to you all, and thank you very much for investing your time into learning about Alamance County government. And I hope that, and from speaking to you earlier, it sounds like you got a lot of value from it. And I think it's awesome that you did that. So the first presentation I have is for perfect attendance for Brenda Pattison. And Brenda gets a special, is this a coaster?
Well, thank you.
And a certificate for perfect attendance.
Thank you very much.
And a certificate for completing the program. So we need to look over that
way. Thank you so much.
Great.
Thank you very much.
You want to tell us maybe what was your favorite thing that you learned or activity that you did?
Well, it was pretty much, I enjoyed every single week, every topic that we had. All the presentations were terrific. And I think for me, it was the evening over at Cedar Rock, where we had, I think, three or four different presentations. It was really fast, but it was really just really showed a wide variety of things, just more than I really knew about.
Awesome.
So, yeah,
that was perfect. Great. Well, good job.
Thank you.
Okay, next we have a certificate for Lynn Long.
EMS and the ambulance, and I liked the airport. That was very informative.
That's awesome.
The airport was much larger than I knew, so.
Cool.
Yeah.
Well, good.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. Great. All right, and last but not least, Bhavna Hilligrass. Did I pronounce that right?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yes, I'd say the Cedar Rock as well as the airport. I didn't know it was there, didn't know how massive it was, and all of the amazing things all the employees do, so that was really cool. Thank
well,
you.
Well, good. Well,
yes.
Great. Well, thanks for participating.
Thank
glad that it worked out for y'all.
Yeah.
So, thanks
you.
Very much. We have some people signed up to be public speakers tonight, and the way that we have a public comment rules posted on our website, and we're allowed to have three topics at the beginning of the meeting. We have public speakers who want to speak on things which are related to agenda items. Our public comment policy, which is posted on our website, notes that each public comment period is limited to a maximum of 30 minutes. There's 3 minutes to speak per person. There shall be no more than three speakers on any one topic per meeting. And we have interpreted that rule to say that we'll have, if there's an agenda item and if somebody is opposed to that agenda item, then there would be three people to speak against it, and then if someone is in favor of that agenda item, then there would be three people to speak in favor of it. So we have several people signed up to speak on the heavy industrial development ordinance tonight. So I'll be asking, when I call your name, if you would please tell us if you intend to speak in favor of the ordinance as it's presented as an agenda item or in opposition to it. Is that clear? Does anybody have any questions about that this time? All right. So the first person we have signed up to speak is Carson Park Rader. Did I pronounce your name properly?
You did. Thank you. Good evening, Chair Gailey and commissioners. Thank you very much for the opportunity to speak tonight. My name is Carson Harkrader. I'm CEO of Carolina Solar Energy, based in Durham. I live in Hillsboro, not too far away. My company was founded by my father in 2004, and I took over the company from him almost 2 years ago. We developed over 40 solar farms here in North Carolina that are now operating across the state, and we are planning for the past year and a half a new project here in Alamance County. I've been investing heavily in the project. We just, after over a year, have received a favorable system impact study from Duke Energy. It's a big milestone. We have been tracking very closely the development of this new HIDO. My employee, Chris Jones, has been to a number of the meetings, including November 4th. He's presented about solar. We believe solar is a very low intensity use. The panels are maximum 15 feet tall. It does not generate traffic. There's no odor, there's no noise or dust, and the solar farms are dark at night. Real estate appraisers have found no impact to property values from neighboring residences that are adjacent to solar, and that's based on multiple matched pair analysis, where equivalent homes immediately adjacent to a solar farm are sold. They compare it with a home elsewhere that's the same in the same neighborhood, and they found no impact over the last number of years of doing these analyses. One thing solar does do is generate property taxes. As you may know, there are 7 solar farms here in Alamance County. We looked at the tax office, and the parcels that now have solar in Alamance County are paying over 1,000% more in property taxes with the solar than those same parcels were paying before. And that's what we typically see, is that great increase because of the valuable equipment that's going into these parcels, and the new taxes often go to help with school funding. We were very concerned regarding the change from solar from class 1 to class 2. My finance provider has told me they will walk away from our Alamance County project if we are not moved back to a class 1 use. The class 1 use has 150-foot property line setbacks and dense vegetative buffer requirements, which are much more strict, twice as strict as what was in place prior. You were already taking a very strong position with those setbacks than what was in place prior, and much stronger than what's in the surrounding counties. I am concerned that with the change you are contemplating to Class 2, no new solar farms will be able to be built in Alamance County. It may be possible to do something in the future, but that may take considerable time from your board, the planning board, and staff. And so my great hope is you will consider making a change for solar back to Class 1. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. So she spoke in opposition to the agenda item. Daniel Roberts.
Hello. Hi, my name is Daniel Roberts. I'm an environmental consultant here in North Carolina. Carson and Carolina Solar Energy asked me to be here and present some of my findings of the new industrial ordinance that you are proposing. The land use limitations puts limitations on actual parcels that could be developed for solar energy. Solar energy is considered a low impact development by DEQ in the state of North Carolina and by most of the surrounding counties. The low impact development is that because of the low imperviousness of the development, the high amount of vegetation that is able to be planted in a solar farm increases the environmental habitats and natural resources that any other type of development cannot do in the state of North Carolina. I do think the operation setbacks and the screening setbacks, the increases are going to be effective, and I think that they will meet the criteria that you're looking for as far as limiting any type of sight or noise impacts that could be created during or after construction or operation. I do have some handouts if that's allowable.
Excellent.
Okay, so here are some handouts. This handout highlights.
Thank you.
Highlights the differences of the operations and the setbacks that would be imposed with this new rule. And so, as you can see from the handout, the increased operations setback from the original solar ordinance would be twice as far, but the additional language of the operation setbacks includes roadways, so it would actually be farther than the aerial that you're looking at. The vegetative buffer is going to be extremely effective. The density of which you've requested is what is used for stream buffer restoration. Decades of research through NC State and NCDEQ has proven that a 50-foot vegetative buffer can reduce up to 99% of sediment, phosphorus, and nitrogen runoff. This is why those are the rules for the Jordan Lake buffer rules here in Alamance County. Alamance County is an important watershed for North Carolina, and low-impact, environmentally friendly development should be encouraged and not discouraged within this amazing county.
Thank you.
So that was in opposition to the ordinance that's drafted. Donna Pope.
Welcome. Good evening. I am Donna Poe from Snow Camp, and I thank you for the opportunity to speak to you once again this evening. I especially want to thank you for approving the HIDO revisions unanimously at the last meeting, as shown in tonight's agenda packet. And I believe our community is better protected under this new HIDO than the previous one, and I thank you. I especially am thankful for the increased spacing requirements and the public notification, the fact that you all have the opportunity to review this before it's approved, the traffic studies. There's many things within there that I'm very happy with, and I truly hope that it is signed and finished this evening. Maybe many of us can sleep tonight. However, as you know, there were additional concerns expressed at the last commissioner's meeting by more than 15 Snow Camp citizens and the dozens of emails sent to you prior. I recall at that meeting that Mr. Sutton and others asked if the additional provisions could be tabled for future consideration, simply in the interest of time. What I heard was that amendments could be made at any time following the initial vote to approve the new HIDO, and that it would just require a new hearing. That being the case, I am prayerfully and respectfully requesting for an agenda item be placed on the next 12-2 meeting to consider a vote to have a public hearing at the following December 16th meeting, if at all possible, where those citizens whose concerns were not addressed at the last meeting can be heard, and possibly those that were not able to attend and speak at the morning public hearing time would then be able to attend the evening December 16th date. Time is important to all of us, including those who took the time to research and prepare for the previous hearing. It is also important that the heartfelt concerns of these and all citizens be recognized and addressed by their elected commissioners sooner than later. So once again, I request an agenda item be placed on the next December 2nd meeting to consider a vote to have a public hearing at the following December 16th meeting, if at all possible. Thank you again for all your care in the HIDO revision process and shared concerns with the citizens. Hope to sleep well tonight. Thank you.
Thank you. I am not sure whether to score that in opposition or whether to
score
that
in favor. I know, sorry. let's go four, okay? Give other people a chance.
Okay. William Flo.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'll be very specific. I sent an email to each of you. I represent Mary Frances Blanchard, who's a resident of Alamance County for a long time, an investor. I live at 4107 Williams Dairy Road in Guilford County, which is southeast Guilford County, and I have an office in Liberty, so I'm sort of in the corner. I'm a few miles from your line, a few miles from Chatham. And so I've had an opportunity to look at other bodies that have considered solar farms in particular, and that's my interest on behalf of Mrs. Blanchard. She's 101 years old, and 3 years ago, she has a farm on Dickey Mill Road. And I asked her if she wanted to sell it, and she said no. We've owned it since 1973, and we feel that something will occur in that area at some point in time. I think she was thinking that water and sewer would come out there, but I don't question her judgment. But she said, don't sell, find a farmer that will continue the lease. And that's what we did. It's harder to find farmers that are in it for more than hobby. And so she was fortunate to find someone, but they're hard to find, and they're not going to sustain someone in their retirement. What she wanted to do by holding on to this farm since 1973 was to create a legacy and to make sure that she didn't have to sell her farm, that she could lease it and create an income. She's a business person, and she looked at it in that aspect. She proved me wrong. I thought she should have sold it. Didn't understand that solar was coming in such a big way. I echo the comments that it's very low impact, and it's sustainable, it's renewable, and it is a technology of the future that would allow her to create a legacy and create an income stream for a over 200 acre farm, which is already has restrictions on streams. It has sediment ponds, it has irrigation ponds, a regular pond, and so the impact would be minimal. And so I'm speaking in opposition to the buffer requirements, to be specific, and I know that you're very much aware of that. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you, sir. Okay, we have John Parks. Mr. Parks?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm actually speaking in opposition, so I'm a local landowner. I actually border Mrs. Blanchard's property, so my comments are, I echo Mr. Flo's comments exactly so. I'm just now sort of, I'm a large animal veterinarian, so I have a lot of clients in snow camp areas in the southern part of the county, so I know all about the mining issues down there, so it's definitely impactful for them. For me, unfortunately, like I think it's hard to look at both of those, solar and mining operation, on the same thing and lump them together. I think that's a fallacy to consider those the same. So, but I'm in opposition, so I think there's a
thank you.
Three questions. So.
Okay. So that concludes our speakers on agenda-related items. Do we have any commissioner responses?
I'm guessing we will go over this when we get to that on our agenda and discuss this at that time and maybe get a little more information on what we can do with that.
Okay. All right. Mr. Parks, I'll just respond real quick to what you said. There are different classes. The quarry is a new class 3. And would have a lot more stringent requirements than the solar farm. They're definitely separate and not lumped in. Okay, so before we move on to approving the agenda, I have an amendment to the agenda to add the appointment of Roger Parker to our jury commission. We can talk more about that when we get to that item. You have Mr. Parker's application for committee membership there, but I would be seeking a motion to amend the agenda to add the appointment of Roger Parker to the jury commission as item 7-1. We do that the first presentation.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to amend the agenda to add the item about Roger Parker being on the jury commission. If there's no discussion, then all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, thank you. And then we need to motion to approve the agenda as amended.
So moved.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second to approve the agenda as amended. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, then we have the consent agenda. Who's next?
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? All right, thank you. All right, so the first item is to discuss Roger Parker being on the jury commission. So what happened was, Jason Ross very graciously had consented to serve on the jury commission, and then once the work started, he realized that he was not able to continue to serve because of a lot of business demands. It takes a lot more time than Jason had realized, and we certainly appreciate very, very much his willingness to consider serving, but he has resigned from the jury commission, and around here somewhere I have a copy of that. Oh, Steve has it. I don't know if everybody has had a chance to see our resignation. So there is a vacant seat on the jury commission, and Roger Parker has graciously agreed to serve on it. So we would need a motion to appoint approve the application for Roger Parker to be on the jury commission.
So moved. Or second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to appoint Roger Parker to the jury commission. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Great, thank you. So now we have a ACC reimbursement resolution. And Susan Evans.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
Before you tonight, first item that I have up for you is a reimbursement resolution for Alamance Community College. What this is doing is it is combining the two reimbursement resolutions that you have already approved for the Center of Excellence and for the parking deck, with Alamance Community College looking at taking those two separate projects and putting it into one. When we consulted with bond attorney, we were advised that we should see getting one reimbursement resolution for that. So when we add those two numbers together, it is still the same cost, but it would be putting it into a resolution that would cover $1.2 million, $1,237,609 for the cost of architectural services and other upfront costs as needed. And at this time, I would need a commissioner to introduce the resolution by title and move for it to be adopted.
So moved.
So, go to read the big part in the block letters. So I'll do that since I have it right in front of me. Resolution of the Board of Commissioners for the County of Alamance, North Carolina, declaring its intention to reimburse said county from the proceeds of one or more tax exempt financing for certain capital expenditures. Is that the motion?
That's it. You made it.
I made the motion.
Bill seconded.
And Bill seconded it. Thank you, Bill. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Okay, capital project ordinance.
Yes, ma'am. So before you tonight is, since we have just approved the reimbursement resolution, what this next item will do is it will provide for a capital project ordinance for that combined project of $17,560,000, which is a portion of $39.6 million bond proceeds to be used for the Natural and Life Services Science Center with the Biotech Center of Excellence and parking for Alamance Community College. This will allow us to budget funds to pay for any upfront reimbursements.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Before we vote, Mr. Albright, there's no problem with the ordinance with Commissioner Sutton not being here to vote. Is that okay?
No.
Okay.
No.
So we.
As long as it meets the three vote approval threshold.
Okay. So we have a motion and second to approve that ordinance. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. All right, Kathy Holland, our director of the Board of Elections, is here to tell us about some voting equipment.
Oh boy.
Interesting.
Okay. So first of all, I'd like to do some thank yous. You know, we have been a long time coming on this project. We have been aware of the change by the General Assembly for a lot of years. So I want to thank the county management team for their continued support of the ups and downs. The IT department, the facilities department for helping us plan what we're going to do with the equipment, finance, HR, I mean, everybody's just been wonderful to us. We've had boards, the Board of Elections, that have come on and gone off through the process. They've all supported us. So we're very blessed to have had good support, and we appreciate your continued support of us as a department as we continue to strive to serve the voters of Alamance County. So just to tell you a little bit about the voting equipment, because you probably haven't seen it. This is what it looks like.
I've seen it.
That's right, you can it. And I, Mr. Carter, were you in there one time? Did you see it as well? This is called the DS200 ballot tabulator. One of these tabulators will be placed in every polling site in Alamance County. Regardless of what else we use in the polling site, this will be placed in it. If you'll notice there on the front, you'll see two locks at the top, then you'll see two bins. The first bin is an emergency bin. If the power goes out, voters can continue to vote on their paper ballots, and they put the ballots in that little door. And then after the power comes back on, the precinct officials will go in and read the ballots through the tabulator. If everything's going good, we have power. So if you'll see the box on the bottom, that blue box, during election day, that box is opened. The ballots, where you read into the tabulator, where you see the little computer screen, where you read into the tabulator at the top, they'll drop down into that box. At night, that box will lock. Now, all of this stays locked through the day, by the way, except for the top part. We have seals, which I'll show you as we go through the presentation. The seals are tracked so that we know the machine is not open. And just to reiterate to you, just as the equipment we have now, this machinery is never connected to the internet. We have no internet connection on anything with this. This is what voters will be marking on. They're hand-marked paper ballots. You'll place these hand-marked paper ballots into the ballot tabulator that I just showed you. This is our ADA equipment that will be used in every polling site for our ADA accessibility requirements. This will also be used at our early voting sites. This is similar to what we have now. You'll see on the side where it says 1, 2, 3, 4, there's a little slot at the bottom, and you can see on the picture, you put a smaller ballot in that equipment, and it is a ballot marking device. You'll hear us through the years refer to as a BMD, that's ballot marking device. So a voter doesn't have to mark their ballot themselves, it does it and it shoots it back out. But then they take that same ballot and they put it in that same tabulator that I just showed you. So that tabulator is used for everything. It has a special section for this size ballot. And that's what that ballot looks like. The ballots again are marked by the ballot marking device, they return to the voter, and they place the voted ballot in the tabulator. And this again is the box. You can see the lock on the top of the box. When the precinct officials, when they pull that out of the tabulator at the end of the night, they will lock that box up. That's what they will bring to us. Those are the voted ballots. Now, I'm going to tell you something different about the ballots that aren't voted in a minute. Okay, this is the ballot distribution bag. So, you know, this is the first time we've used a massive amount of paper ballots. We've used maybe 100 per precinct for curbside voting and provisional voting. That's what we usually send out. So we're going to be sending out thousands. So this is a new adventure. So when the precinct officials pick up their supplies from us the day prior to the election, this is what we will issue the bulk of the ballots in. And these ballots, again, they'll be shrink-wrapped so that we can identify the number for a chain of custody. And we'll also have this bag locked, and it will be sealed, and it'll have the seal number for a chain of custody, so we'll know the bag hasn't been entered or tampered with. And that goes to the precinct. Actually, it stays with the precinct official overnight, and then they take it to the precinct the next day. Okay, these are some of the seals that we're using. The two seals, the two green seals, they're the seals that would go on those two flip-top locks. We put one on each of those, and then you can't see it, but there is a lock on the other side of the computer screen that locks the access to pull that tabulator out. That the top part of it, where the machine, the computer screen is, that comes off. So we need to lock that, so that's locked with this seal. Then for every door that opens, we have that sealed with one of the red seals. And we keep the tracking numbers on each of those seals, and they're verified through the chain of custody. This will be our new voting booth. Voters will go up to those with their paper ballot to mark the ballot, or if they're using the express vote, the ballot marking device, that will be placed inside that booth. So we'll have a considerable number of those. This is our central tabulator. We have one now. I think if you've been there for a recount, and I think everybody in this room's been there for a recount, this is what we will recount with. This also will tally our absentee ballots that come back to the office, as well as the provisional ballots. And it will serve as a ballot counter if we have to, or after the election, we're required to do a 30-day sort, which we've done with this equipment very quickly because it's electronic. But with the new equipment, the 30-day sort will be done manually. So this will help us count the number of ballots that we have to go into that manual count.
So if we had to do a recount in a year like next year, 2020, how long would that take?
That's why we're buying two. It would take a considerable amount of time. We vote 70,000 plus people. I anticipate we could hit 80,000, I hope. I mean, you know, I have lofty goals.
Wow, that'd be great.
Well, we had 72,000, and again, we have had a population boom. Absent of this law that required us through the General Assembly to get new voting equipment, we needed additional equipment because of the population boom. But we knew for, what, 4 or 5 years we were going to have to replace the equipment because of General Assembly guidelines. So we didn't want to buy equipment that was going to be decertified. So we're maybe buying a little bit more if you just look at it initially, like we don't have that many now, but we needed more. You ride down the interstate, you see the apartments coming up. I mean, there's a boom. So we're excited about the process. We're excited about what we're doing. There's going to be a lot to do in the next few months. I was telling Mr. Boswell before we started, early voting starts on February the 14th. Candidate filing is December the 2nd. So and we don't have the equipment yet. Once you sign off on this and Brian writes me a check, Susan, and we're expecting delivery within 3 weeks, we're told by the vendor, so we should get that sometime in the middle of December, and then we begin to train. We're already, we have a demonstration, that was a demo that we have in the office. We're already looking for large events to go out and take the equipment. We're trying not to focus on individual Rotary clubs or church groups, you know, because we don't have the staff and we need to reach as many people as we can to get the word out before March. So,
well, you have to have more precinct workers with this. It seems a lot more labor intensive.
You know, Mr. Boswell, eventually we may need just a very few less, but right now, because this is totally different to Alamance County voters, we're going to, I call them the bouncers. We're going to have a bouncer at the door to make sure nobody takes their ballot out with them, because we're not used to doing this. This is a totally new process. Mm-hmm. And it's like I said, an adventure.
Work your way through it.
We're going to work our way through it. We're going to train. We're going to train the public, and we hope that the public will come into the office to view, just like you have, the product that we have, and we are excited about it.
I'm sure y'all will do a good job.
Well, appreciate it.
Okay, so there's no more questions. We can move on to the voting equipment financing aspect.
Thank you, Kathy.
Good job.
Thank you, Kathy.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Kathy.
Good evening, Commissioners. Before you now is a resolution which will authorize the county manager as well as the finance department to now move forward to obtain a bank financing agreement that is authorized by North Carolina Statute 168-20, which would identify the needed findings for this offering and will give us the authority to issue the request for proposal. We are looking to request a financing term of 4 years.
I want to say, Commissioners, that this purchase has been included in our capital financing plan. So we've been working with Kathy for quite some time to put together the numbers. So we have the capacity to borrow these funds to buy this equipment. So we're set to do it with the funding that we have. So.
And what this resolution will also do is it will cap the funding at $1,125,960. We would not exceed that one amount.
You need a motion?
Yes, sir.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve that financing. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay.
Now before you is another resolution. This resolution will allow the county to pay for the upfront costs that are associated with purchasing the voting equipment. Due to timing, we're going to need to go ahead and move forward with that process while we are issuing the RFP. So at this time, I would need a commissioner to introduce the resolution by title and move for it to be approved.
I don't think I have that in front of me. Does anybody do you have
I do. I think this is it. Whereas the County of Alamance desires to purchase the voting equipment desired and the attached list identified as Exhibit A. I'm on track here.
Just that block that's in
the bold print.
Oh, authorizing the manager and finance department staff to proceed to obtain a bank financing agreement authorized by North Carolina General Statute 160A-20 to purchase boating equipment.
Yes, sir.
And I will submit that as a
vote. Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay, so then a public hearing is next.
Yes. Now that we've approved all of our resolutions, before you now is a request to set a public hearing on Monday, December the 16th at 7 o'clock p.m., which we would bring back the results of the RFP for the Board of Commissioners to approve who would be able to provide us with that equipment installment loan.
I'll make a motion that we do set a public hearing for December 16th, 7 o'clock.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to set that public hearing. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay,
thank you
very much.
Thank you, Susan.
Tanya Cattle, we are looking to apply for a grant to take care of some abandoned mobile homes.
Right, this is a grant that has been around for a little while. Alamance County's gotten this grant since 2013. Just a few numbers since relatively new. We've gotten rid of 55 single wides and four double wides since 2013, 513 tons of landfill debris and 81 tons of recycling from these mobile homes that we're getting rid of. This is a little bit odd because this grant, I mean, y'all got a lot of paperwork in front of you. They sent quite a package this year, but I thought y'all would enjoy reading every word, so I sent it out to you. But this also includes municipalities. We can go into their jurisdictions and they can send us applicants for this. You have to qualify by owning the mobile home yourself. It can't be under tax lien or everything's got to be cleared on it. The property owner has to turn all the power off and pull everything. So we put an RFP out, get somebody in to physically go in, take them down, take them apart, and distribute them where they need to go. The property owner just has to turn everything off and then we take care of the rest. Any additions, decks, blah, 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 the property owner takes care of. This grant does not cover it. It also does not cover mobile homes in mobile home parks. They have to be on private property. But overall, this has been something that's really good. State has done a good job with Alamance County taking care of everything. It's relatively simple. We apply, we get whatever monies are. Only have $80,000 for the whole state this year, so we'll see where our allocation is. And then we kind of get the money, we pay the people. It's that simple. There's no travel, there's no training, there's no anything. We hire somebody, they take care of it, we're done. 6 weeks, we're out.
And do they apply through your office?
They can. Yes, the application's online. We are going to go ahead and take applications, even though we haven't applied for the grant yet. That way, when we get the grant, we won't lose any time. When it's cold, it's wet, it's frozen. These are hard times for them to get in and clean them up. So as soon as we find out about it, we'd like to get them in there early spring. So we have all our applicants cleared for it. Like I said, we don't know how much money we get. So depending on how much we get is how many we can do. Double wides cost a little more than single wides, so it depends on what kind of applications we get.
Did you say that they have to turn the power off?
Yeah, the property owner will. And once we tell them that they're a qualified applicant, that's when we let them know.
So do power has to turn
the
whole
power.
Yes,
they disconnect everything. Okay. So when they come in, I mean, it's pretty awesome when they come in and just take
them
tear apart.
It's hard to get electricity if you don't have the power on.
That's
right. They just literally take machinery and rip the roads off and rip the sides off of it, pull the windows out. It's pretty awesome to watch when this happens.
There's no match required.
No match, no anything. Just give us money. We have somebody else, they take care of it, it's done.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve applying for that grant. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, the next item on our agenda is to review and formalize the amendments of the Heavy Industrial Development Ordinance. Per our discussion at the November 4th meeting, I hope that the other commissioners have had the opportunity to review the drafting, the text of the revised ordinance to be sure that the revisions line up with the discussion we had on November 4th. I looked at it and I saw the video and it looked like that's what we said that we wanted so at that time. So to who may have any discussion or thoughts about it, they want to share.
Well, I think the solar situation is something I know that, you know, we talked about that the last time, and I don't know where we could reclassify this, and if we need to go ahead and get this passed and then come back and revisit that. But I ride through Elon every day. Solar farm right there, 25 feet from Front Street, and it's not a overly obtrusive type situation. I mean, they've got some plantings there, and it's good. I mean, personally, I think it's a good situation. And what you mentioned about there's no traffic generated out of, once this is set up, it's there. It just sits. I don't know. If you look over there at their solar farm going through Elon, they hadn't got 25 feet off Front Street until you see their panels sitting right there. So I don't know if we've kind of pushed something that's good for us as a state to, you know, they're helping to generate power, which in the long run will help reduce energy producing plants. I don't know, it's a tough situation there, and have we pushed back too hard on that one particular industry? I don't know. And I don't know where we go with that, since we've already put them in there, do we back up a little bit?
Well, I think the issue that caused us to go from a class one to a class two with solar was the issue of, I guess it's kind of a...
They're getting penalized because of somebody else didn't do what
somebody else
has
really messed up the process and done a poor job of creating a buffer and maintaining a buffer around their existing solar farm. So it put us in a position of trying to protect the rest of our citizens from the same issue. So the term I used was guilt by association. I know that's probably not what you want to hear, but... Somehow we've got to make sure that we don't have other citizens deal with the same problem.
Can I address the?
No, I'm sorry. It's not appropriate, but thank you. It's a time for the board to discuss. We've already talked about it. I guess I would ask the commission going forward, do you all... Well, strike that. I'm not gonna go with that right now. Tonight we have before us the question of whether or not the work that's been done by the legal department accurately reflects the discussion that we had at the last meeting. And is there a consensus that it does?
I think everything is that. The only question I have is that in that class situation. And of course, I don't think we can vote on that because we don't have all members of the board here tonight. We will not be voting on this tonight anyhow.
That's correct. So I guess we will continue to discuss and look at whether or not there's a will of the board to revisit the issue of the solar farms and their classification, as well as the other things that Ms. Poe has been bringing to our attention over the last 10 minutes.
Could I ask the environmentalist gentleman, what are the typical setbacks in Orange County? Because I know they've got a number of them around.
Orange is 30 to 50.
30 to 50. And other counties?
About the same.
30 to 50.
And is that from the property line, or is that from the center of operations?
That's from the, it varies county to county. The average is from the development line, so anywhere you would put your erosion sediment control. So like that's the area of development versus the property or the center.
That's from the exterior property.
Right, from the exterior property line.
Into your first panels, basically.
Yes.
So that sounds to me different from what we've even talked about.
Right.
In terms of this ordinance, that's a whole nother thing.
Yeah.
A whole nother.
They moved it back to us, class one, we would be looking at a 75-foot setback, right?
Is that right?
Right.
Class one, I think, is 75 property line back to the facility, basically.
Class one is Article 7, you have a procedure for granting a variance.
Oh, okay.
Well,
you
that's
may
a
want
good
to
idea.
That before you amend the ordinance.
That's a great idea. That's a great suggestion that you can the applicant can ask for a variance.
And so that, they would have to come back through planning to ask for that
page
variance.
19 of the HIDA explains the process.
Right. Okay.
All right. Well, that's a good suggestion.
And the new class one is 150.
Right.
That's a lot of difference.
Yeah. 0.75. Yes.
Okay, so I think that we have a consensus that the draft that's presented tonight formalizes what we decided the last time. So there's no vote to be had on that tonight. So we'll move on to the next, unless there's more discussion. I don't want to cut anybody off.
No, I mean, as long as that is an option that they can put into their plan to come back and just basically appeal it, and we can make a variance for that.
I think there were some other issues that we probably want to look at moving forward, adding to the ordinance, but I know we've got a deadline bearing down on us in December that we've got to deal with, so.
That's right.
I'd like to see us address some of those other issues that have been addressed to us in the past, too, so.
Okay. All right, Mr. Haygood, you have an employee handbook update.
Indeed. Good evening, Commissioners. Our Alamance County Employee Handbook needs to be revised. This information I'm going to go over with you, and that's been included in your packet, does not require a vote. This is simply an update to the board. I like to bring this information to the board because it establishes in the minutes that this change has been made. So if we ever need to go back and research these changes, they have been benchmarked. But the changes that we're planning to make to the Employee Handbook regard grouping retiree health insurance for county employees into four date ranges. The current language in our employee handbook is inaccurate. And you have a document in your packet that is called Retiree Health Insurance Benefits. Looks like this document here. That's going to be the new and accurate language for our employee handbook. Employees are separated into four groups based on hiring ranges. All four of these groups have been established by the Board of Commissioners previously through votes. We went back and researched the actual dates that these votes were taken by the boards of commissioners that established these different groupings, and you have in your packet minutes. We included minutes to back up the four different groupings, so you can take a look at those if you have any questions. But after this evening, our handbook will be corrected and will be reissued to county employees with these clearly defined groups that are based on previous board of commissioner actions. That new document, the new language, will also include corrected language to reflect current practices of the county if a retiree returns to work with Alamance County in a benefit eligible position. That information will be corrected in the handbook. And some language in the handbook will also be corrected concerning premiums once a retiree becomes Medicaid eligible. So again, these do not require votes. It's just making our handbook accurate for our employees based on what the board has already done in the past. And there was one other change that came to light as we've been going through our open enrollment process, and it has to do with the commissioner retiree information. I sent you some information about this earlier today. Mm-hmm. So this is a hard copy of what the current language in the handbook is and what we will change it to be to match action that the board took in 2008-09. So we'll enter this into the minutes, copy to our clerk. Again, this does not take a vote either, but this corrects what is in our current employee handbook to reflect what the board did in 2008-2009, so you can see the current language and the change. So, again, there's no action needed by the board. This is how we establish different versions of our handbook. So I'll be happy to try to answer any questions.
Thank you.
think this will help make sure our employees all understand their approved benefits, and that we keep our handbook accurate. And as we make changes, we're working on revising the handbook for best practices, not for accuracy. So we'll be bringing it back to you after the first of the year, talking to you about that.
Thank you. I think you did a good job.
All right.
Thank you. Okay. Do we have a budget amendment regarding voting equipment purchase?
Good evening, Commissioners. The final agenda item that I have before you tonight is a budget amendment that will allow us to go ahead and budget $1,125,960 based upon the approval of the reimbursement resolution for the purchase of the voting equipment.
Motion to approve.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve that budget amendment. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, now it's time for public speakers on non-agenda related items, and we had Donna Poe sign up for that.
Hello again. And thank you again for the space to speak. I wanted to publicly thank you all for your decision 1 month ago to enlist the services of an independent outside counsel. I am, however, a little confused as to the role of the attorney's engagement. It was unclear to me at the meeting when this was discussed as to what and how the duties of this independent attorney would be asked to perform. Specifically, I would like to know, number one, is the intent to have the outside attorney review item by item in detail the July 1st, 2019 letter sent by our attorney outlining apparent violations of the HIDO that occurred with the intent to construct permit issued to C. Wayne McDonald? Number two, will he be responding to our attorney as requested in that letter? And number three, has a time frame for the permit review been discussed, and if so, what is it? As expressed earlier this evening, time is important to all of us, including those who have spent thousands of hours and dollars in research, phone calls, emails, meetings, public awareness, along with our having to hire our own attorney for ongoing legal advice, who we believe has already provided you with a thorough review. Thank you again for your continued care and shared concerns for the citizens, and I ask for continued prayers for strength in this journey as we witness, work, and wait according to God's will and purpose. And I have a list here of my three questions, just so you have in front of you, to discuss.
Thank you. Be sure to give one to Clyde.
I don't have a copy for him, sorry. There you go.
Did you take the notes?
Okay, do we have any commissioner responses?
Well, Clyde, do you have any thoughts on the questions that were raised tonight? These questions.
He has been engaged to review the permit. I don't have the letter in front of me, but it's the items that the board asked to be reviewed. Four or five specific things you want to input. That's the kind of detail he's got to go into. I just got the complete file today. Massive. I tried to email it to him and it kept bouncing back. So
is this off. From where? State? From Apple?
Where?
Oh, from us.
Right. Our files. So we'll be going in express mail tomorrow.
Do you think you could please forward a copy of the letter that you sent to him with the questions to the board, please?
I think I already have, but I'll be glad to send it again.
If you did, I don't recall.
Well, will he be responding just to us, or will he be responding to the plaintiff's attorney as well?
I believe the board wanted him to respond to the board first. But that is his instruction.
We definitely need to know what's going on.
I'm sorry, what was you said in a closed session.
He will respond to that.
And then you folks can decide the next step.
That sounds perfect. Okay, anything else? Mr. Manager, Mr. Hager, do you have a report?
No report other than to say we've appreciated Kathy Holland's hard work on all this voting equipment. That's been a long saga, and she has done a fantastic job keeping us posted, working very hard for Alamance County's interests at the state level, and we appreciate it.
People have no idea how awesome our Board of Elections and Kathy Holland and the work y'all do, and the people who come out and work those precincts. It's amazing.
They are dedicated.
They are dedicated, and they're smart, and they're kind, and they're just angels.
They're crazy.
Yeah, and they're crazy to do it. We're so grateful.
How many precincts will we have in 2020 now? I know the number was increasing.
We have 37 now. We need to split some. It's just finding the locations. We have been working with Marlena, who is a treasurer. In our GIS department, we're actually meeting with her again this week to try to split at least South Melville and South Boone next year, which is the community center, Northern Arts and Community Center, and Smith Elementary School.
There that are is a busy area.
It is. Mevin is just exploding.
You anticipate the possibility of 80,000 voters?
I do.
Y'all, we're
like I said, it may be a lofty aspiration because I believe everybody's as interested as I am. But
is it any hope of stopping them without proper identification? The dead likes to come back every 4 years and vote.
They've got to have voter ID this year.
That's good. That's a good thing.
The implementation of photo ID is another aspect that we're looking at training on before the March primary. So we've got a lot of tasks. Thank you for your kind words. I appreciate
that. Anybody else have any comments? Okay. So I have a motion to go into closed session. I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.1183. In order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board and consider and give instructions concerning a settlement offer in the case of Alamance County versus Karens Incorporated. And I also move, I can do both of them in one motion,
yes.
Right? I also move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute 140, Section 143-318.11A6 to consider the performance of a present employee.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, do we have a motion to return to open?
I'm not going to lie to you.
We have a motion and a second to return to open session. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? And in closed session, the board gave instructions to the county attorney concerning the case of Alamance County versus Karens Incorporated. And on the personnel matters, no action was taken. So that's that. And all the remainder of our, we're adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Grand. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the County Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGovTV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.